This week on Cracked Science, how media hype can give legitimacy to Deepak Chopra and his friends. Hey, this is Jonathan Jarry, and you're watching Cracked Science, a show from the McGill Office for Science and Society that separates sense from nonsense on the scientific stage. A month ago, you may have seen this stunning headline. The interstitium, the largest organ we never knew we had. The human body was thought to have 79 organs, until researchers stumbled on a strange phenomenon that could turn medicine and what we thought we knew about the body upside down. This kind of attention-grabbing headline is typical of a lot of science news stories. Media outlets need your eyeballs in order to compete in this crazy information age of ours. So they love to sell stories such as, everything we know about the pinky is wrong, it's not even a finger. The problem with these exaggerations is that scientific discoveries are rarely revolutionary. Science progresses in small steps, but small steps aren't very sexy, hence the hype. Now, the headline I just showed you from the Daily Beast was not the only one touting this game-changing discovery. Many more were selling you the idea that a brand new organ had been discovered. So what is this interstitium? Well, imagine a wet sponge in which we embed rather large beads. The beads represent our organs. The spongy material in between is the interstitium. It's a network of cavities filled with fluid that envelops our organs. Now, I know this because I flipped through a 55-page scientific review of everything that we know about the interstitium and its role in inflammation and cancer. You may be surprised that scientists went from not knowing this organ existed to filling 55 pages with words like polyanionic and fibrinogen in a span of 4 weeks. That's because the interstitium isn't new. In fact, I threw the word interstitium into Medline, a database of biomedical journals, and the oldest hit I got was from 1970, which was a study on the intestinal interstitium in chlamydial calves. Chlamydial calves, the new fragrance by Calvin Klein. Watch for the discharge. Clearly, the interstitium is not new, so why were we sold this falsehood? Dr. Neil Theis, a liver pathologist in New York, along with numerous colleagues, recently published a paper in which they used an interesting technique to visualize the interstitium. And in the first paragraph of that paper, the authors admit that we know the interstitium exists, but that its structure is only vaguely described in the literature. They are claiming to have found an expansion of it. From here on in, it's the broken telephone game. Next in line is the PR release. The center where they work put out a public relations release to draw the attention of journalists, like putting chum in the water. It's meant to accurately explain the work that was done, but look at the title, Researchers Find New Organ. Then comes a journalist from the Daily Beast, who writes her article like she's gotten the scoop of a lifetime. She meets with Theis in a Manhattan deli, and he allegedly tells her, unlike what he wrote in his paper, that he stumbled upon a hidden organ. Now, the journalist does admit in her article that this interstitium was previously known, but claims these doctors were the first to define it. But it's the headline, cooked up by the Daily Beast, that people will see and remember as they scroll through their newsfeed. Now, all of this may seem like a little bit of harmless hype. Who really cares if the public wrongly believes some doctors found a new organ? Well, I care. But as I've been told time and time again, I really need a better hobby. The most pernicious aspect of this hyped-up release is the wind it blows in the sails of acupuncture. Here's an excerpt from the Daily Beast article that makes this specific connection. In fact, Theis expanded, this interstitium could explain many of modern medicine's mysteries, often dismissed by the establishment as either silly or explainable by other phenomena. Take acupuncture, Theis said. That energetic healing jolt may be traced to the interstitium. Indeed, many acupuncturists took to their blog to celebrate the news that Western doctors were finally catching up to Eastern wisdom by reminding their public that this interstitium, which had apparently just been discovered, was known to the ancient Chinese and actually called the triple burner. And you know what will give you the triple burner? Chlamydial calves by Calvin Klein. But seriously, one acupuncturist even quoted Shakespeare and wrote, "There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy." Now, regardless of the fact that the interstitium isn't new, and that the hypothesis that it explains acupuncture is itself old news, as this 2002 paper demonstrates, does it explain how acupuncture works? Actually, that's the wrong question to ask because it implies that acupuncture works. Acupuncture doesn't work. I know, some of you will say, but it worked for me, you haven't tried it, how would you know? Silly skeptic, so close-minded. Actually, I did try acupuncture, and for chronic pain too, which is a condition for which it should probably work if it works at all. I did 4 sessions of laser acupuncture, and yes, that's a thing, followed by 4 sessions of traditional needling, and it didn't work for me. In fact, my pain got worse. But putting aside my experience, I want to go over some little-known facts about acupuncture that will hopefully change your perspective on it. The ancient Chinese either prohibited dissections, or at the very least, discouraged them, so that they didn't know much about what the human body looked like on the inside. Meridians, acupuncture points, these are not based on anatomy because they didn't know anatomy. They were guessing. Acupuncture made a resurgence in China in 1949 during Chairman Mao Zedong's Communist Revolution. He wanted to make China great again and offer his people a medicine that was essentially made in China. He also wanted the people living in the countryside to have some sort of medicine to turn to, but didn't have the money to give them actual doctors. So he brought acupuncture back into fashion, despite the fact that he didn't believe in it. He even told his own physician, "Even though I believe we should promote Chinese medicine, I personally do not believe in it. I don't take Chinese medicine." The smoke and mirrors of acupuncture only reached the modern West when a reporter went with Henry Kissinger to the People's Republic of China in 1971 in preparation for President Richard Nixon's visit. The reporter got appendicitis in China, and following surgery was treated for pain using acupuncture. The pain went away, and he wrote about it for the papers. Soon, Americans and Britons were clamoring to learn more about this traditional medicine. But the question remains, does it work? The best tool we have to evaluate if a treatment works or not is the double-blind, placebo-controlled, randomized clinical trial. And our best trials have shown that acupuncture is simply placebo theater. It may make you feel a little bit better in the moment, but it offers no treatment to your underlying condition. So here we are, in 2018, assaulted every day by hyped-up information which affects our thinking. In this case, we went from a scientific paper which should have been published in a pathology journal, but which was instead rejected by 8 different journals before being accepted in a journal that is not a pathology journal, showing us visualizations of a tissue that was known to exist and had been fairly well described before, to having its lead author tell an impressionable science reporter with no scientific background that he's discovered a new organ, and it might just explain acupuncture, which, by the way, totally works. And here is said author in conversation with a luminary, that is Deepak Chopra.
I'm in the middle of a shamanic initiation, so curious about non-material beings and such.
So the science stuff started, I think, as a spiritual practice, and was content to let the science path and the spiritual paths just be separate. I had no particular urge to merge them, until they just started merging sort of spontaneously.
And because of these distortions of scientific facts, we might soon see books like this one, selling you nonsensical advice on how to take care of your interstitium to achieve optimal health. And because these distortions came from trusted sources, you might end up believing in them. Because who wouldn't believe a show called Science Friday that airs on NPR?
This is Science Friday. I'm Ira Flatow. Have you thought about your interstitium today? You never heard of it? Well, apparently it's a new organ. Scientists say we never knew we had. Does this discovery lend any sort of mechanism for acupuncture or acupressure working? Yeah. You know, explanation for it? Because I've heard this on the news all week.
I would say both Neil and I are actually quite tickled by that. I think it does suggest that there may be, a very clear anatomical mechanism for the way acupuncture works, and for the fact that acupuncture does work, which I think has been very well shown.
If you need help extracting the hype from alternative medicine and figuring out whether or not any of this works, I highly recommend the book Trick or Treatment, Alternative Medicine on Trial by Simon Singh and Etzan Ernst. If you think my snark will antagonize believers, be reassured that this book is snark-free. I love their approach, which is curiosity-driven, gentle, but firm when it comes to looking at the evidence. They cover acupuncture, homeopathy, chiropractic, and herbal medicine, and is one of my favorite books on the subject. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, do click that button and ring that bell to get notifications. In the meantime, you can follow me on Twitter @CrackedScience and join us next time for science that may or may not be all it's cracked up to be.